Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this special joint event co-hosted by La Trobe University's Greek Studies program and the Greek Orthodox Community of Melbourne and Victoria. I'd like to begin on behalf of both organisations by acknowledging the traditional owners of the lands on which we've gathered this evening, the Wurundjeri people, and I'd like to pay my respects to their elders past and present. It gives us great pleasure to present this lecture tonight. It's timely given all the activity that's going on in the region around Cyprus at the moment. Our speaker, Dr. Georgios Kazamias, is Associate Professor in Modern European History in the Department of History and Archaeology at the University of Cyprus. He's also worked in the past at the Balkan Studies Institute in Thessaloniki, as well as at the University of Bradford in the UK. His research interests include Europeanization, the history of the international relations of Greece and Southeastern Europe, the economic history of Cyprus, microhistory, oral history, and the digitization of archives. The title of his talk tonight is From Pragmatism to Idealism to Failure, Britain in the Cyprus Crisis of 1974. Please make him feel welcome.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like first of all to thank the organizers for inviting me, for kindly inviting me and making me very welcome. It's not the first time I speak in Melbourne, but it's been a while before. I mean, since the last occasion when I spoke. At the time, it was the old building of the community, so a much smaller, slightly different oriented room, which most of you would remember. But anyway, it was quite a nice atmosphere as well. I will begin with a professional complaint, so to speak. I envy colleagues working on ancient or Byzantine history who only have a limited and published amount of sources to work with. We in modern and the contemporary field have so much to work with that we can hardly hope to have even reviewed or relevant material sources by the time we finish working on a presentation. So by definition, and contrary to popular belief that considers us a sort of all-knowing prophets, most of our work is fragmentary and fragmented. If there are any younger and aspiring scholars in the audience, bear this advice in mind for your future choices. This is the abstract of my talk, which has been published. What I will focus on, first of all, is a number of questions. Was the partition of Cyprus a planned event? Who was behind it? What was the British attitude to this plan? Was this policy a success for Britain? We will attempt to answer some of these questions in the presentation. Not all, and not all in a satisfactory manner, certainly not a satisfactory manner to all of you. Was the partition of Cyprus a planned event? I will start from the beginning. A few years ago, perhaps a decade ago, while browsing in the National Archives of Australia online, electronically, I discovered a telegram on which started my research and what you will listen today. It is my nomenclature, the Australian telegram of 20th and 21st of July 1974, which, as you will see, is quite an interesting thing, and you will see that what it gives us an indication of policy behind the scenes, behind the spotlight. This is a facsimile of the telegram. Don't read it now online. Now I'll come back to it throughout the talk. As I said, I came across it online in the National Archives of Australia when checking for material relevant to the Cyprus crisis and the invasion of 1974. Let us look at the text of the telegram. Above is the series and the references, necessary references for the archives. As you will see, it's a telegram to Canberra, copied to Athens and to Ankara, coming from London. It begins in a relatively unproblematic way. Cyprus, British policy. You will have seen media reports of Turkey's invasion of Cyprus on 20th of July by FCO, foreign and FCO. FCO stands for Foreign and Commonwealth Organization. Spokesman has summarized British objectives as being threefold: to protect the British lives and property, put pressure on Turkey to stop the fighting and on Greece to do nothing to make matters worse, and to get takes, meaning talks, starting in London. I've tried to find any sort of traces in the Foreign Commonwealth Office in the records. No trace of this meeting appears to exist. This doesn't mean that the information contained is fake. It's an official document in an official repository. So we can assume that this documentary record that it's enough to confirm that it is genuine. The second paragraph, commenting privately to us on the situation on 20th of July, a senior Foreign and Commonwealth Office official said that Britain secretly would not object if Turkish military forces occupied about a third of the island before agreeing to a ceasefire. Please protect. Such a position would need to be reached by the 21st of July if peace prospects were not to be endangered further. In the meantime, Britain continued to support publicly appeals for an immediate ceasefire. The next paragraph. Now, according to the same source reports from the British ambassador in Athens, expressed concern that the present military regime in Greece may fall and be replaced by an even less desirable one. There is some feeling on the FCO that were Greece to intervene militarily in a land war with Turkey, she should end up with a bloody nose. In his London talks last week, Makarios asked the British frankly what he should do. He was encouraged to go ahead with his plan to go to New York and await developments there. There seems little prospect of his returning to Cyprus in the near future, if at all. Some observers have suggested the president of the Cypriot National Assembly is a positive alternative head of state to Samson, who is unacceptable to the Turks. Britain is acting diplomatically, not militarily on the text, militarily is the meaning, in the current crisis. The only military moves have been related strictly to the improvement of the security of the sovereign base areas, SBAs. Over the last 24 hours, some 1,500 British troops have been flown to Cyprus for this purpose. You may notice that there's a handwritten note at the bottom of the telegram. This reads: "This is Glathkos Kleridis." Sick goes because Kleridis usually spelt his name with a C, not with a K, who I gathered when in Athens is a very good type, not a thing like Samson. query, however, whether Kleridis would wish to supplant Makarios. He might agree to be acting president, underlined and quotes in the original, for a period of time till the dust settled. Kleridis is respective in Athens and Ankara. He would need pretty cast iron assurances of local support, even as acting head. The signature is Hugh Gilchrist. Gilchrist is somebody you, many of you may be familiar with. The name would be, you would be familiar with him. The contents of the second page in paragraphs, and I will come back to Gilchrist in a minute. The contents of the second page, paragraph 6 and 7, which I have not read or transcribed, appear much less important. They refer to the evacuation of foreign nationals by the British forces in Cyprus, paragraph 6, and an FCO request to the Libyan government for a Qantas overflight of Libya. There is also a handwritten note above which I read you. And Gilchrist was a career Australian diplomat who had been the ambassador to Greece and Cyprus during 1970-1972. Gilchrist later went on to write a monumental history of the Greeks in Australia, published in 2004. Now, that's all and good, but why did the Foreign and Commonwealth Office notify Australia of its policy? We speculate because in 1974, Australia was a non-permanent member of the Security Council. In fact, it was the only non-permanent member of the Security Council openly aligned to the Western Alliance, to NATO. The other members were Austria, the Belarusian Soviet Republic, Costa Rica, Indonesia, Iraq, Kenya, Mauritania, and Cameroon. So accepting the permanent members of the Security Council, the United States, Britain, and France, all members of NATO, the rest were either neutral by treaty, Austria was not allowed to be a member of any alliance, or non-aligned or third world countries. Getting back to the first paragraph of the telegram, what were the openly declared British objectives? First, to protect British life and property. That's all. It's perfectly acceptable. It's part of any country, of the remit of any country, to protect the lives of and property of its citizens. Stop fighting. Of course, no country wants war to go on. Prevent the expansion of war. Get talks started in London. Eventually, the talks when they started were not in London, but that's beside the point at this stage. What the British said was sent to another 16 diplomatic missions, 8 and copied to another 8 on the 20th of July. All these are highly commendable aims. Nothing out of the ordinary, therefore, in the first paragraph. And now we come to the surprising comments. Paragraph 2 has got 3 surprising comments. It reads, I will repeat the text now, commenting privately to us on the situation on the 20th of July, a senior FCO official said that Britain, the bolt in mind, I've added for clarity, that Britain secretly would not object if Turkish military forces occupied about a third of the island before agreeing to a ceasefire. Please protect. Such a position would need to be reached by the 21st of July if peace prospects were not to be endangered further. In the meantime, Britain continued to support publicly appeals for an immediate ceasefire. Well, what are the 3 surprising statements? First of all, the readiness of Britain to accept in Cyprus a fait accompli. That a fait accompli that resulted from the Turkish military action already underway. What is written and stated is written at the beginning of the 20th of the Turkish invasion. The second statement is a surprising timescale set. The occupation of one third of the island has to be completed within 48 hours of the beginning of the invasion. The third statement, a specifically defined area, one third of the island, that Her Majesty's government would suffer Turkey to occupy. This area was occupied by Turkey, but when was it occupied? As you may well remember, it was occupied by Turkey approximately 3 weeks after the date of the telegram, the 21st of July, and following the second wave of hostilities in the period 14th to 16th of August. It should also be noted that this territorial extent matches the area of Cyprus described as the Turkish military objectives by the British military air force in their reports. Now, was Britain ready to accept a fait accompli, resigned to accepting it, or complicit in accepting it? Britain was many things at the same time. It was ready to defend the sovereign base areas, had actually moved troops to Cyprus or kept them there because they were there before the Turkish invasion. So she had strengthened the garrison of the sovereign base areas. Britain was not prepared and was probably not ready to use the military action to stop the invasion underway. Could she do it? We'll come back to this later. There is, however, no evidence of complicity between Britain and Turkey. Turkey had talked to Britain on the 17th of July, after the coup, but before the invasion. And in fact, Britain had refused to allow the Turkish invasion to launch from the sovereign base areas. At the same time, neither two superpowers, the U.S. and the Soviet Union, or the United Nations for the international community, appeared prepared to intervene. Now, why then a deadline in the paragraph? So why does the action have to be complete by the 21st of July? Several reasons that this could be the case. Fear of the effects of a generalized Greek-Turkish war for the NATO alliance. The famous the edge of the NATO alliance that could be jeopardized by a Greek-Turkish war. The effects on the anticipated future settlement of Cyprus. That is clearly mentioned in the paragraph. And also fear of Soviet intervention. Soviet intervention was unlikely, but it was theoretically possible, but certainly could not have happened unless there were movements of troops that would have been taken note of, and so the other side would know that something was boiling. On the 20th of July 1974, 48 hours were considered military adequately for the success of Turkish aims, and not long enough to cause a wider conflict, if everybody played along. A parallel thing far away from Cyprus and Greece, for example, during the Cold War, Norway was, in the event of a Soviet attack, Norway was supposed to last for 2 days. And after that, the West would have found a solution to the problem. In a similar manner, 2 days are considered just about adequate for the Turks to complete their war aims. Now, the first ceasefire that was brokered by the United States in Cyprus was to take effect on the 21st of July at 1600 hours local time, i.e. within the 48-hour window. The second ceasefire, that was supposed to take into effect 2 hours later, sorry, 24 hours later, on 1600 hours of the 22nd of July. As we know, this was a ceasefire that didn't really take place. On the battlefield, the Turkish military was not as successful as anticipated in this time frame. So what do we have now, up to now? A specifically defined area, a time frame, 48 hours, and somebody who's playing and not playing along. What I mean is that the resistance of the National Guard and the Greek forces, the Greek side generally, was more than, and much more than everybody expected. Now let's look at the history of the rule of thirds. We saw that a third of Cyprus was supposed to be taken over by Turkey within 48 hours. Now, why a third? In 1957, Fazil Küçük, in his book The Cyprus Question, A Permanent Solution, on the cover of the book, there's a map of Cyprus divided along the 33rd parallel, approximately where the current green line is. The 1960 Constitution provided that two-thirds of the civil servants in the Republic of Cyprus were to be Greek, and one-third were Turkish. In March 1967, Gallo Plaza, the UN mediator at the time, after the 1964 crisis, to Uthant, the UN Secretary General, reported that the Turkish proposals for Cyprus are a Turkish zone in the northern part of Cyprus, an area of approximately 1,084 square miles, or 38% of the total area of Cyprus. There's a third instance of the war of the law of thirds, rule of thirds. Now, what were the minimum war aims of Turkey just before the invasion? Ecevit, on the 13th of July 1974, went with the biggest delegation to London and had talks with Britain. This was not, there's nothing that we need to be suspicious by this. It was an obligation of the garant on powers to talk to each other in case of that crisis. So talk first and then do whatever you feel you need to do. So Ecevit goes to London, has a talk has a meeting in Downing Street, and then we have the minutes of this, and these have been published, so this is nothing secret. He says that the minimum Turkish requirement in the future, whatever the status of Cyprus, independent or whatever other arrangement, would be to secure access to the sea somewhere near Turkey, which would enable his government to prevent Turks from dying from starvation, as had occurred in the past. According to Echevit, this cooperation would be welcomed by everybody, the Greek and Cypriot people included, would restore the democracy to Greece, would justify British military presence in Cyprus, and also return NATO unity in the region. In other words, the best thing anybody could invent since sliced bread. What did the British reply to this, this offer? The Prime Minister said that he understood Mr. Cevit's remark as an expression of the Turkish wish that Britain would not blockade an action of the kind contemplated by Turkey, but that they would blockade the Greeks. Mr. Cevit asked if Britain would be ready to do so. The Foreign and Commonwealth Secretary said it was not impossible. This acquiescence seems to be the closest Britain got to cooperation with Turkey. So, if the Turks refused to play along, how was the gap bridged? How did the rule of thirds come into the Australian Telegram as something was prepared to see, Britain was prepared to see happen, albeit secretly? One possible interpretation could be that in this paragraph, the senior FCO official that was mentioned in the telegram earlier on appears once more to state what Britain was expecting would happen and could not prevent, so pragmatism, and therefore what Britain was ready to accept on the first day of the Turkish invasion, given the likelihood of success of the invasion, as forecast by its own military experts. It is true that the British experts thought that we cannot stop the Turks. We can only speculate as to the identity of the official, persons with seniority within the FCO at the time, whose names appear in the files were Sir Thomas, later Lord Brimelow. He died in 1995, and he was the permanent Under-Secretary in the Foreign Commonwealth Office in 1973 to 1974. Sir John Killick, he died in 2004, the Deputy Secretary of State, FCO, and Sir Alan Goodison, the head of the Southern European Department. Now, we've spoken a lot about Britain now. What was the US policy towards Cyprus in 1974? In 1974, Henry Kissinger, was the foreign secretary, was the main player. The Watergate scandal was in full progress. Nixon could resign on the 9th of August, 1974. And what Kissinger was saying is this: we do not want to tip our hand on a Cyprus solution yet, till we know what will come out of it. And the other thing that Kissinger said, this was on the 18th of July. The other thing that Kissinger said is just repeat our standard line on the territorial integrity of Cyprus. Does this ring a bell? It is the standard line that any government would come up with in crisis when they don't have something to suggest. In another contemporary discussion in Washington, this time it is not Kissinger who's being asked. It is a senior U.S. diplomat. The question, how much of Cyprus do they want to take? All of Cyprus? And I said, no, they will go for the northern third, rule of thirds again, which is enough to establish the strategic control over the island. The interview took place on, I don't have the, I don't have the date actually, but it was part of the briefing, that the US briefing on the Cyprus crisis. With the coup against the Makarios, the Washington Special Action Group was set up to respond to the emerging crisis. On the 18th of July, in the meeting of the Washington Special Action Group, Kissinger seemed unclear. Though he accepted the possibility of a Turkish intervention, he also asked to be briefed on the availability of the military forces for use in Cyprus, both US and British, but decided that, quotation, "We do not want to tip our hand on a Cyprus solution yet, till we know what will come out of it." Referring to, then he just said what I already mentioned, just repeat our standard line on the territorial integrity of Cyprus. There was also the decision to stop military deliveries of military aid to Greece, not to worry whether the Ioannidis regime in Greece survived. The essence of the above was included in Telegram 15,603,012 from the Department of State to certain posts with the subject "Policy Considerations in Cyprus Situation," date Washington, 18th of July 1974. And there is also a transcript of a telephone conversation between the Secretary of State Kissinger and the Director of Central Intelligence, Colby. Kissinger, what do they think they're after? They are the Turks. They're not after the whole island, are they? Colby, no. What they would be after would be Famagusta and Kyrenia, and the kind of line between the two. Kissinger, what kind of quadrangle in the northeast? Colby, yeah, well, call it almost the inaudible, from roughly Baranaka on up, and then just assert themselves and give themselves a position to bargain with. Kissinger, do you have any good ideas what we should do? Colby, well, I think the biggest thing is to get the Greeks not to fight. To say, all right, let's negotiate and discuss what ought to be done. Okay. Kissinger, okay. Now, Baranaka is a place in Indonesia, nothing to do with Cyprus. It's a probably mistake. It's a mistake for Larnaca. Now, the closest we find in Cyprus is Larnaca. This is, however, in the southern part of the island. So they probably made misplaced information. The only way Larnaca could be in the target of the Turkish invasion would be if this took place in the British base of the Kelia, i.e. in the southeast of Cyprus, and then if the Turkish forces moved towards the southwest to Larnaca, rather than north to Famagusta. Even so, this sounds implausible. And if Baranaka means Larnaca, it would point to a gross failure of intelligence by the US. Larnaca is also incompatible with a reference to Famagusta and Kyrenia, also in the telegram, a little previously in the same conversation. How about the United States and the rule of thirds? US policy was the acceptance of the rule of thirds, that is mentioned in another Australian telegram, Ankara to Canberra. Although Turks may not have achieved full military objectives, Americans here believe that they may now be ready to accept a ceasefire. And it continues, Americans consider the Turks would not be willing to surrender areas captured, except for minor adjustments, but will seek to hold these so as to secure permanent access to the sea and security of Turkish minority. As a consequence, some movement of population might therefore be involved. Now, at this point, Turkey was surprised at the extent of the of the Greek resistance, that is also mentioned in the telegram, as well as the Turkish inability to achieve a quick victory. By the 22nd of July 1974, Turkey has not achieved its war aims. It only has a foothold in Cyprus. Greece has not declared war on Turkey, and is the foreign minister of Britain the odd man out? Has he been left in the lurch? And this is the point where Britain organizes the first round of talks in Geneva, Greece, Turkey, and the UK, to stabilize militarily the situation in Cyprus. They last until the 30th of July, and a number of initiatives were taken to strengthen in this period, to strengthen the UN forces by turning British troops from the sovereign base areas. The question of Nicosia Airport, that the Turks desperately wanted to capture, and they were prevented first by Greek forces, then by the UN contingent. The question of a naval blockade by the Royal Navy, that was put together. A proposal for which was advanced by the sovereign base areas commander, and also the evacuation of the foreign troops from the conflict zone. This took place. In fact, a few years ago, I met somebody who was in part of this evacuation in 1974 in Australia, actually. At about the same time in Washington, Secretary Kissinger, said that it is against our interest to have the Greeks in there, in there meaning Cyprus. A strong Turkish presence would be highly desirable. What went wrong anyway, he's asking. Colby, they've turned out to be tough. They being the Greeks. Between the 30th of July and the 14th of August now, things go pear-shaped, if you can allow me this reference. The Turkish military enlarges its hold. Its hold is enlarged by 130 square kilometers between the 22nd of July and the 8th of August. That is before the second round of the invasion. It was approximately 1.4% of the total land area of Cyprus that was occupied. The military experts, the UNFISIP, the British and Turks and Greeks, Greek officers, failed to agree on the precise extent of the Turkish occupied zone. At the same time, the Royal Navy scaled down its presence in Cyprus. It actually sent away two of the four ships that it had. Now, does this mean that Her Majesty's government abandoned the rule of thirds territorial policy described in the Australian telegram? What appears to have been adopted instead was that what could be called the one-shot policy. Callaghan's thinking probably was that Turkey had its chance to get what it wanted in Cyprus and had limited success. Now negotiations would have to shape the future. Furthermore, after the ceasefire of 22nd of July, and even more so after the conclusion on the 30th of July of the stage one negotiations in Geneva, Britain apparently assumed that at least the main part of the fighting in Cyprus was over. That negotiations were seen as the next logical step for Britain, that is implied by the comments in the British cabinet that assumed that the Turkish invasion had failed. and also by the enthusiasm of the British delegation after signing the Geneva Declaration on the 30th of July. There's a description of the British delegation saying that when we were waiting for the plane to get back to the UK after the first stage of talks, we almost started singing Rule Britannia. Now, however, what goes on is much more difficult. Between the 10th and the 14th of August 1974, there's the second Geneva Conference on Cyprus. Britain, James Callaghan, Greece, Georgios Mavros, and Turkey, Turan Gunes, and Greek Cypriot representative Glafkos Kliridis, and Turkish Cypriot representative Rauf Denktas, so five delegations go to Geneva, Callaghan tried to put pressure on Turkey by threatening military action, or by threatening to interpose the British and UN forces between the Turkish and the Greek forces. Now, this interposition would not have made a military difference. It was merely a psychological move. Would the Turks have dared to open fire on foreign troops? Now, this was a good idea, but even Waldheim, most possibly influenced by the United States, does not agree to this. And anyway, as this is a telegram from the Foreign Secretary to the Prime Minister of the United States, of Britain, Foreign Secretary, British Foreign Secretary to British Prime Minister, from the Prime Minister's minutes, from the mission in the UK mission in Geneva to the Foreign Commonwealth Office on the 12th of August 1974, where he states that the United States could not consider military action against the Turks. It was out of the question at the time when a new US administration was taking office. Kissinger does not consider threats of military action are helpful in present circumstances. Such gestures tend to create problems for Ecevit with extremists in Turkey. It has been made clear to Hartman, that was the US envoy to Geneva, that I am not contemplating any further military action at the moment, and that a new action on reinforcements has been suspended since yesterday. What Callaghan was trying to do was keep alive a military action, the military options, excuse me. So he was trying to make sure, give a semblance of a credibility to this. And of course, Kissinger kills this, not directly, but indirectly, makes sure that nothing will have come out of this. And in another very interesting paper in the National Archives of the UK, Goodison to the private secretary for Secretary of State note a few basic principles on the 11th of August 1974. He states, we have no long-term interests in Cyprus, which we do not share with the Americans. We should take no forcible action except in cooperation with the Americans or with the support. Note that in two lines, there's two references to the Americans. Now, in Cyprus, there's a firmly entrenched public belief that somebody in the Greek junta had an agreed plan to partition Cyprus with or without fighting. also that Britain is perfidia Albio, apis the Alviona, unreliable Britain. What the Australian telegram shows us is that Britain entered the Cyprus crisis with at least an understanding that the Turkish invasion was bound to succeed, probably with some advanced notions of the Turkish territorial goals the invasion would produce. Was there a plan? Was there an agreement? We can only speculate on this. No concrete written documentary proof has been uncovered to date. At the start, Britain may have been perfidia, but probably not Callaghan, not Callaghan himself. The crisis in Cyprus, this is what the British record calls it, was quite traumatic, quite a traumatic incident for James Callaghan, the British Foreign Secretary. Of course, not no loss of life or property for him, as was the case for about 200,000 Cypriots, but something as punishing for a politician. He lost face and was made to appear weak in front of another power, Turkey, and that was not a great power either. What must have been as galling was that the special relationship of Britain and the United States could not help him get the results that he considered positive and to an extent just. In this case, the United States was working with Turkey against Callaghan's choices, and Turkey was meaning on the back of the United States. In a way, we can say that the 1974 Cyprus crisis was James Callaghan's own little Suez, as it was in 1956. The complete paper is freely available online in this website. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Kazamias, for that sort of presentation, and I'm sure there'll be quite a few questions from the audience. The speaker will take questions in either Greek or English. So.
Thank you. I'd like to make a comment rather than a question. Every time when there is a reference on the Cyprus problem on the international media, they refer to the coup d'etat in Cyprus as being the purpose of it was to make enosis of the island with Greece. And the remarkable thing is that every time I hear, at different times, the reference to the Cyprus problem and the reference to the coup d'etat, the wording is exactly the same, no different. It's as if all these journalists, whenever they might be at whatever time, they have some written script that they pick up and they repeat repeatedly. Now, as far as I'm concerned, the purpose of the coup d'etat, it's well known. It was to eliminate Makarios. And since everybody expected that Turkey would initiate military action, it was obvious that the fact that Greece didn't take any precaution, any measures, that some kind of double enosis was arranged. It wasn't a question of single enosis, because if it was, it would have been declared. Instead, what we have is some kind of a deal for a double enosis, and the well-known remark by Brigadier Ioannidis, "Μην ανησυχείτε, Ignacia κάνω, μια γωνίτσα θα πάρω." Μια γωνίτσα θα πάρω. This is my comment. Thank you.
You're quite right, and you're spot on as far as the persons in the drama are concerned. The problem was that Ioannidis, who was the only person who could give an answer to this, took the secret to the grave. He died without. He only gave, I think, one interview to Karadzaferis in 1975 or 76, and then nothing. So we don't know who led him on, I think it's a case of him being led on, or who persuaded him to go ahead and organize a coup, which was certain, as you very correctly said, the coup opened the door. And it wasn't the case of the coup taking place and then 5 days later an invasion taking place. The invasion was getting ready for a long, long time before then. There's no way you can launch a credible invasion with a five-day window. It must have been prepared a long time before then.
Hi, thank you for your very informative speech. You can speak in Greek if you like, if it's easier for you. You can answer in Greek. It will be easier for us to, you know, because you're not so comfortable in English. I just wanted to say two things. One, it is very obvious that the US and England have always were behind the invasion. In fact, they encouraged the junta to go into Cyprus in order for the Turks to invade. As you said, it was you know, all set up. And in fact, the invasion was well prepared by the Americans and the English, as some of your documents said. But there's more revealing documents I encourage you all to read. They are all in Argyroula, what's her name? Fanula Argyrou. Fanula Argyrou, she lives in England, and she is in the British Library the last 30, 35 years going through the unclassified documents that the English let out. And she's got amazing information on how they are, like, you know, right behind it all. And I wanted to make a comment and then make a question. Is that okay? Because these are things that have not been heard. Do you mind? Good, thank you. That's wonderful. Lipon. So I encourage you to read that. And I also want to say that we could have stopped the invasion after the first invasion when Karamanlis was in power, because we had 3 weeks. Like you said, you know, they only occupied a very, very small part of the island. However, Karamanlis was told not to do anything by the Americans and the English. Και είπε ο Καραμαλής το γνωστό, η Κύπρος κοίται μακράν, which means Cyprus is very far away. Really, I mean, Cyprus was abandoned to its own devices, as it is abandoned right now, and you know the Turks are 60 miles out of Cyprus. However, you know, no one is going to go out there and defend Cyprus. It's still abandoned to its own devices. And I wanted to ask you what you think will happen from now on. How do you see the whole situation from now on?
Thank you.
As I said, right at the start, everybody thinks we are some sort of prophets. We cannot tell what the future.
We're recording your answer. We're recording your answer. So to
yes,
hold your account.
I know that. Go back to what your comment was. If and the early stage of the invasion, if Greece had intervened, it would have got a bloody nose, as the Americans were saying, and that is a really bad comment on the colonels, because they were military, but they never did anything to prepare Greece for this eventuality. It is a very short point in Cyprus that nothing was done. A really short point. But if anything was attempted, with no air cover, no chance of anything successful or even livable.
But we had the capacity to do so.
A good point, but we didn't.
But everybody agrees we did.
We didn't. We had the super weapon of the time, which is a Phantom, whatever it was. I think the Phantom planes, But even these, even with the additional tanks to give them more flying time, could only operate something like 12 minutes over Cyprus. How far away is Cyprus from Turkey, from mainland Turkey? 60 miles, which means that air cover is all in one hand. And even actually the plans for using the super weapon, the Phantom planes, assume that they would go to Cyprus, bomb for 5, 10, maybe 10, 12 minutes, and then go to Lebanon and land there and get interned for the duration. End of the story. That is the story, that is what the famous capability comes down to.
There was a stage, I think in the 70s and 80s, when the US provided military aid to Turkey and Cyprus, to Greece and Turkey, it was in a 7-to-10 ratio. Mm-hmm. Was that always the case beforehand, or that happened after the invasion as sort of some type of, compensation to Greece or whatever?
After the invasion, there was an embargo on arms from the U.S. to Togo, Cyprus, sorry.
Turkey.
And this embargo was lifted by the Carter administration. And that is when the ratio of 7-10 was instituted.
A select committee of commons, which was set up to examine this, the Britain's role in the invasion, Callaghan, he was persistently asked, why haven't you done that, why haven't you done? Eventually, he had to say, but what can I do? It's the Foreign Office. So it's quite complicated, really. And if you watch the British comedies, the Yes Minister, you will see exactly how the Foreign Minister. By the way, the Select Committee of Commons found three outcomes. Britain had the military capacity to intervene, had the moral obligation to intervene, had the legal right to intervene. Yes, the governor, nothing. That is the Select Committee of Commons. So thank you.
If I may just use the minute while the question is being prepared. Morals and international politics don't go together. It's really power politics and nothing more. And what's moral, what's nice, what's good, is neither here nor there. Sorry.
Εγώ τα πω στα ελληνικά λίγο, ότι μου βγαίνουν καλύτερα. Εγώ έχω τον πατέρα μου που ήταν στο ναυτικό στην Ελλάδα επί Χούντας. Και θυμάμαι, και ο πατέρας μου ισχυρίζεται ότι πάει στην Κύπρο όταν έγινε αυτή η κρίση. Και συγκεκριμένα μου λέει, περιμένουμε να απολυθώ, γιατί απολυότανε. Και ξαφνικά, πάμε στην Κύπρο, είπαν οι ανώτεροι του. Και λέει συγκεκριμένα για κάποιες φάσεις στην Κύπρο που έγιναν, που τον πετάξανε πίσω από τις γραμμές και βομβάρισαν χωριά, μας λέει. Και ότι μερικοί σχολούν ότι η Ελλάδα δεν έκανε σχεδόν τίποτα στην κρίση, επειδή ακούγοντας αυτές τις ιστορίες από τον πατέρα μου και από φίλη του που είχε από το ναυτικό, ο πατέρας μου ήταν ειδικές δυνάμεις, να αναφέρω στο στρατό, το θεωρώ λίγο... Δεν το θεωρώ σωστή πληροφόρηση, μπορώ να πω. Γιατί έχω ένα πατέρα που πολέμησε σε αυτά. Και το ότι η Ελλάδα δεν έκανε τίποτα σε μια φάση που η Ελλάδα ήταν επί Χούντα, επί Παπαδόπουλο και πίσω από μια Αμερική, πιστεύω ότι η Ελλάδα έκανε ό,τι μπορούσε. Μπορούσε να κάνει παραπάνω, γιατί ο πατέρας μου λέει κάποιες ιστορίες που εμείς έτοιμοι ήμασταν. Την εντολή δεν πήραμε. Αν πήραμε την εντολή, θα τους να το στρώγαμε. Τον συγγνώμη.
Έχετε δίκιο. Μέχρι την εντολή δεν έφτασαν. Αλλά δεν ξέρω σε τι αναφέρεστε. Η μόνη περίπτωση που ξέρω, αλλά και πάλι είναι από προφορικές μαρτυρίες, για μεταφορές πυρομαχικών όμως, μόνο πυρομαχικά, στην Κύπρο, είναι μεταξύ της πρώτης και της δεύτερης εισβολής, δηλαδή μεταξύ 30 Ιουλίου και 12-13 Αυγούστου. Είναι με καΐκια από το ναυτικό, αλλά με καΐκια, ώστε να μην μπορούν να εντοπιστούν. Λοιπόν, ο ΙΚΑΣ δεν ξέρω να πήγανε. Τα καΐκια με τι να μου βοηθήσουν.
Μπήκανε σε φορτιά, στούρβων και σκοτώσαν όλους. Με λέει, ανεπίσημο
να σας πιθανόν αναφέρεται σε ένα σχέδιο που υπήρχε και το οποίο δεν τέθηκε σε εφαρμογή, να γίνουν τέτοιες ανέργειες στα μετόπιστα των Τούρκων, μεταξύ, πριν τη δεύτερη φάση της εισβολής. Τέτοιες σχεδιασμοί υπήρχαν, αλλά όσο ξέρω δεν έγιναν, δεν εφαρμόστηκαν. Σχεδιασμοί δηλαδή για να δημιουργηθεί χάος στα μετόπιστρα. Θα πρέπει να το πράξει λίγο περισσότερο με τον πατέρα σας. Βεβαίως, τον ξέρω. Πριν από 10 χρόνια περίπου. Πριν από 10 χρόνια περίπου συμμετείχε την κυβέρνηση.
Όχι, το 2015 ήταν στην κυβέρνηση.
Πιθανόν, ήταν σύμβουλος.
Όχι, ήταν...
Θέλω, δεν έχει σημασία.
Ναι.
Ναι. Δεν είναι κυβερνητικό πόστο αυτό. Οκ, εντάξει, συμμετείχε. Ναι, ναι.
Ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ. Όταν πρωτού γίνει η αποβίβαση των Τούρκων στην Κύπρο, ο Ετσεβίτ, ο οποίος ήταν ένας από τους σοσιαλιστές, πήγε στο Λονδίνο και οι Εγγλέζοι είναι οι πιο βρωμεροί. Διέρη και βασίλευε. Τα ξέραν όλα, είχαν βάλει σε εκεί πέρα και λοιπά και πήγε ο Ετσεβίκη εκεί πέρα να τους πει να προχωρήσουμε. Και στέλνει τελεγράφημα στην Κύπρο και λέει στη γυναίκα του υποτίθεται, στείλε την κόρη μας διακοπές.
Εσύ μπορεί να πάει διακοπές.
Εν τω μεταξύ, όταν έγινε η αποβίβαση των Τούρκων στην Κύπρο, οι Έλληνες και είχαμε και την ΕΛΔΙΚ, μια ομάδα, δεν ξέρω πόσο ελληνικό στρατό ήταν εκεί πέρα. Τι κάνανε, κάνανε την προσευχή τους και οι Τούρκοι μπαίνανε μέσα, δηλαδή εντουφέκητοι. Δηλαδή ήταν δικό μας το σφάλμα, κοιμόμαστε. Συγγνώμη γι' αυτό.
Συμφωνώ απολύτως.
Σημειωτέων ότι ο Τσεβίτ μαζί με τον Κίσιντζερ ήταν συμφοιτητές στην Αμερική, στο Πανεπιστήμιο, σε ένα πανεπιστήμιο της Αμερικής. Τι άλλο ήθελα να πω. Συγγνώμη, κάτι μου πήγε. Ναι, συγγνώμη, δεν το θυμάμαι.
Η γραμμή που κρατούσες ότι ο Κίσιντζερ και ο Τσεβίτ ήταν συμμαθητές στην Αμερική.
Ναι. Ναι. Όχι, απλώς ο Κίσιντζερ, βέβαια είναι ο Κίσιντζερ, δεν χρειάζεται να πούμε τίποτε άλλο. Αλλά το γεγονός ότι ήταν συμφοιτητές ήταν κάπως ευνοϊκό. Αλλά συγχρόνως όμως να διορθώσω κάτι που έχετε πει. Η Αμερική γύρω στο 63 ή 67 ήταν η Τουρκία πάλι έτοιμη να εισβάλλει στην Κύπρο. Και την σταμάτησε η Αμερική. Δηλαδή, ας βλούμε τα πράγματα στην παγκόσμια. Λοιπόν, το 74 η Αμερική ήταν αναστατή λόγω του, πώς τον είπαμε,
το Watergate.
Το Watergate. Το λοιπόν, επομένως λοιπόν, δεν μπορούμε να πούμε ότι γιατί η Αμερική δεν είχε τόσο πολύ turmoil η Αμερική τότε, που δεν μπορούσε να επεμβεί και να ήθελε να επεμβεί. Η Αγγλία, η οποία μπορούσε να επεμβεί, δεν επενέβηκε για τους γνωστούς λόγους. Αλλά πρέπει να λέμε και του στραβού το δίκαιο, ότι ο λόγος που δεν επενέβηκε τότε η Αμερική ήταν λόγω της εσωτερικής κατάστασης. Όχι, είχε επέμβει το
1964 και είχε
ζητήσει. Δύο σύντομες ερωτήσεις ακόμα. Γιατί εντάξει, έχετε όλοι πολλά να πείτε. Κανένας άλλος.
The question that I have to ask is this. We pretty much know what happened after 1974. My question is this. There seems to have been a period, and I'm sure lots of people have read a lot. I've read Makarios Drusotis' book recently, and there seems to have been a hell of a lot going on our side before, in the period immediately before this. There seems to have been a lot of backward and forward about getting rid of Makarios. There were several attempts on his life, and we all pretty much know that 1960 was a compromise that neither side really wanted. And in the subsequent years between 60 and, say, 74, it was a matter of time before something like this happened. In many ways, don't you believe what happened was inevitable?
It was not inevitable.
Inevitable, like whether correct to either side.
It was not inevitable in that we opened the door. It was the Greek stupidity. And I'm not talking mainland Greece or Cyprus, or Greek Cyprus. It was the side that made the invasion possible. That's what it boils down to.
It was our actions over several years, is that what you're saying?
You could say that, but it was not just our actions. It was what the other side also did. I don't like the word inevitable in this thing. Expected, perhaps, or should have been expected, is a better approximation of the of this. So was the junta.
So was the junta.
It wasn't just that.
Clinton actually came to Greece and he
apologized
about this. He apologized about it publicly. They were behind the junta. They were financing them, both, you know, extreme situations to get us to this point. The U.S. was not. Are you listening, sir?
Okay. All right. Okay, I will take one final question. Okay, εντάξει, μπορεί να συνεχίσετε μετά, δεν τελειώνουμε εδώ. One final question from anyone who hasn't asked a question or hasn't made a comment? Or? No? Okay. A big round of applause for Professor Kazamias, please.
Thank you.
Just a small gift from the community, a few books for you to take back to Cyprus. And just a reminder, we've got two seminars coming up, the Thursday seminar from Phil Kafkalidis, and on next Monday at the Pan-Acadian House, Acadian House in North Melbourne, 570 Victoria Street, Professor Petros Themelis, archaeologist from the University of Crete, who's done some excavations on the ruins of Messini, will be speaking there. So 6:30 next Monday. Okay, thank you very much for coming tonight.